From Hollywood, the CBS Radio Workshop.
Well, from where we sit in this air-conditioned, glassed-in control room high above the floor on the Convention Coliseum, it would appear that Eustace J. Favorite's son has the nomination all but sewed up. He's only 10 votes short of the needed 667, and New Mexico's 16 votes can put him over the top. The roll call is about to continue, so now back to Sam Pierce on the convention floor.
There's Sam Pierce once again. Believe me, ladies and gentlemen, the final moments of the 64 convention are really something. Well, Larry Thor is here on the floor with me. Larry, do you have a comment?
Yes, I do, Sam Pierce. It seems to me that the final moments of this 1964 convention are really something.
That's how I would have put it, Larry Thor. Chairman Cal Porter is pounding the gavel for silence now, and it's my guess New Mexico will throw her entire 16 votes for Eustace J. Favoritson. Right, Larry Thor?
Right, Sam Pierce.
The convention will please be in order. Whereas in previous years, many delegates complained that they did not get to wave a sign in front of the cameras and thereby missed the opportunity of obscuring the television audience's view, this year, all delegates without signs to hold have been given balloons on long strings. This way, everybody gets to hold something. But this morning, two states got into a fight over civil rights, and Alabama broke an Oregon balloon with a lighted cigar. Now, balloon breaking is the kind of thing that can split our party. So let's have respect for the other fellow's balloons, at least in front of the television cameras. Now, New Mexico.
New Mexico, 16 votes.
Mr. Chairman, New Mexico, home of the pinto bean and the land of 10,000 lakes, proudly casts its 16 votes. In a moment, the result of those votes. But first, Mother and Dad, thinking of sending the kids to camp this year? Don't you do it. Bring the whole family to fabulous, colorful New Mexico, home of the pinto bean and land of 10,000 lakes. Say, you can bet your bottom dollar...
I rise to a point of order.
May I remind the chair that under the unit rule, I have a full minute for my state commercial.
That is true, but your slogan is home of the pinto bean and land of enchantment, not land of 10,000 lakes.
Mr. Chairman.
The chair recognizes Minnesota.
Land of 10,000 lakes is Minnesota's slogan.
I know, but I like it.
All right, New Mexico, that will do.
No, if I can't have land of 10,000 lakes, I don't want home of the pinto bean.
Oh, well, then take home of the jumping frog. That hasn't been used.
Mr. Chairman!
Chair recognizes California.
Before the chair gives away jumping frogs, I would like to call attention to the fact that the original jumping frog, which Mark Twain immortalized, was an amphibian from Calaveras County, which is in California!
Yeah! Order! Order! Order!
Mr. Chairman?
Order!
Mr. Chairman?
The chair recognizes the delegate from Missouri.
May I remind the delegate from California that the birthplace of Mark Twain was the little town of Hannibal on the banks of the Mississippi in the great and glorious state of Missouri.
Order! Missouri, sit down. New Mexico won't use your old frog.
I will if I want to. I got to where I like it now. New Mexico, home of the pinto bean and a jumping frog.
New Mexico? New Mexico, you can just hand me your balloon.
This is Sam Pierce again. A delegate from New Mexico is visibly shaken by the chairman's rebuke. He's relinquishing his balloon now. Well, this is a tense moment, ladies and gentlemen. Anything can happen now. Anything.
Mr. Chairman, are we here to squabble over slogans or nominate a candidate for the presidency of the United States of America?
First things first. Now, New Mexico, how about home of the Western Meadowlark? That has a nice sound.
Mr. Chairman, the Western Meadowlark is the state bird of Montana.
Well, you could share your bird with New Mexico. That's the American way.
I won't do it.
All right, then. Here, New Mexico, here's a dandy. New Mexico, overflowing with the milk of human kindness.
Point of order. Point of order. Mr. Chairman, Wisconsin is America's dairyland.
Oh, sit down, Wisconsin. Sit down. Sit down. Now, this convention will come to order, or I will take away all of your Mouseketeer hats.
What'd you turn the set off for? That was Stan Freeberg kidding the political convention.
I don't care. He makes me mad. He doesn't take anything serious.
Yes, he does. That's satire.
Satire? What's satire?
In the next half hour, we will attempt to answer that question as CBS Radio presents the CBS Radio Workshop, dedicated to man's imagination, the theater of the mind. Tonight, Colloquy 3, an analysis of satire. What is satire? How does it differ from wit, from humor, from criticism? Is it all of these or none of these? To help us answer this question, the CBS Radio Workshop is proud to present one of the most penetrating young satirists of our time, the Capitol recording star, Stan Freeberg.
Thank you very much and good evening. Well, what is satire? That's a good question. Well, there are all kinds of satire. We opened the show tonight with a political satire, for example.
Yes, and it was an outrage to right-thinking Americans everywhere.
Well, just a minute. You can't come bursting in here.
Oh, yes, I can. I am the censor.
Oh, you mean the network censor?
Oh, no, 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 no. Censor with a capital C. I represent society.
With a capital S?
No, lowercase. I represent public opinion. There are some things too serious to be kidded, too sacred. Big business, labor, the farmer, the American way, mom, politics.
What's the matter with kidding politics?
You can't afford to offend one party or the other.
Oh, but that little exercise in rodomontade was not directed at any political party. I was only poking fun at the absurdity of all conventions.
Well, maybe. But you offended the states. The idea, having the delegates carry balloons.
Tell me something. Did you watch the conventions recently?
Of course, and very carefully, I can tell you.
Well, then, honestly, didn't they look a little like big rowdy kids? Sort of a ding-dong school with delegates?
That's a slanderous statement. I might even say a dangerous thought.
Oh, come on. All I suggested was this could be a convention of 1964 if they keep on at the rate they're going.
What do you hope to gain by such impertinence?
Gee, frankly, I don't know, but I can't help myself. A lot of things and a lot of people strike me as being funny, that's all. And by holding up a satirical mirror to them, maybe in a small way I can help them to laugh at themselves. And then everybody might be a little wiser. And even maybe a little happier.
Yes, but you went too far when you put mousketeers' hats on the delegates. Now that is defamation.
No, it's not. It's all in fun. Where's your sense of humor? Besides, our political conventions are nothing more than glorified Mickey Mouse cartoons anyway.
Watch your tongue. Watch your tongue.
That's not my tongue. That's Will Rogers' tongue.
Tch, I don't believe it. Will Rogers was a great American. He wouldn't have said anything like that.
Well, gee, I'm sorry to argue with you, sir, but in September 1932, he did say it. Listen, this is what Will said.
Well, our national political conventions, if you have ever attended one or heard it over the radio, are nothing more than glorified Mickey Mouse cartoons and are solely for amusement purposes.
Unquote.
I just can't believe that 100% American like Will Rogers could have...
gotten away with it?
Shocking. Simply shocking. Why, it verges on the seditious.
Look, if you don't mind, I'd like to get this show on the road.
All right, go right ahead. Please. But I warn you, I'll be making notes of everything you say.
Fine, be my guest.
May I borrow your pen?
Oh, certainly, here you are.
Oh, I hate ballpoints.
Aren't you afraid you'll offend the ballpoint people?
Don't you get smart with me, young man.
All right, sorry. Now, where was I? Oh, yes, what is satire? Well, it's a lot more than pointless fun-poking. Satire is criticism, first, last, and always. But criticism disguising itself in the bright robes of barbed wit. The jester may insult the king, so long as he does it with a laugh. So criticism, arm in arm with humor, glides confidently past the censor.
Well, you're not gliding past me, young man.
I know, I know. Satire is as old as man's pomposity. More than 2,000 years ago, Juvenal pierced the stuffed togas of ancient Rome with the same weapon Alexander Pope used to clip the powdered periwigs of 17th century London, or Ogden Nash to puncture the tinsel bubbles of Park Avenue's pretensions. But long before these viewers were alarmed, there was a playwright named Aristophanes, a Greek. He didn't think much of the works of another playwright named Aeschylus. In fact, he seems to have come to the conclusion that Aeschylus was one Greek who didn't have a word for it. At least Aristophanes wasn't bearing any gifts when in his great satire, The Frogs, he had this to say of Aeschylus.
I know him. I've seen him years ago, wooden-mouthed. No door, no bolt, no bridle to his tongue. A torrent of wild bombast. Intelligible? Not one line.
24 centuries later, a contemporary satirist felt the same way about rock and roll.
Life could be a dream. Life could be a dream.
All right, hold it, you guys. This is a rhythm and blues number. You gotta be careful or somebody liable to understand what you're singing about. You want that to happen?
No.
Well, then you gotta talk unintelligible like me, right, Stella?
You said it!
Okay, now you guys want to sell a few records?
Yeah!
Well, then stick some old rags in your mouth and take a guess from the top, okay?
Okay.
I don't understand the words now. Real mumbly. Life could be a dream. Shaboom, if I could take you up with a dying of love. Shaboom, it will be done. I'm the only one that you love. Life could be a dream. Sweetheart, hello again. Shaboom, hello,
we'll meet again. Intelligible? Not one line. But satire's weapon is the same, exaggeration. There was another top tune a while back that came marching out of my radio so often I began to think my set had been made in Texas by Texans. Remember? Got so the only place you could escape it was diving for abalone in the Straits of Juan de Fuca. So fearful of being snare drummed to death, I rushed to the studio and recorded this.
Say, nobody else could miss her, not half as much as me. She cried so when I left her, pardon me. Oh, that's just a shade loud on the snare drum.
She's sweetest little rosebud that Texas Avenue. Her eyes are bright as diamonds, they sparkle like the dew.
See, now you covered up sparkle like the dew. One of the loveliest parts in the whole Texas.
Hey, what's the idea of turning it off?
I warned you, and you've gone too far.
Oh, please.
That is a direct insult to the Lone Star State, to say nothing of Southern womanhood and the memory of the boys in gray.
You think maybe I should have cleared it first with the state capitol at Austin, huh?
They would never have given you permission.
See what I mean? You see what we're coming to? It won't be long before you'll have to carry a license to laugh.
Exaggeration again?
You think so, huh? Listen, before I was allowed to laugh at Jack Webb, I had to get his written permission. And the only reason I ever got it is that Jack's shirt is not stuffed. He thought this was funny.
The legend you are about to hear is true. Only the needle should be changed to protect the record.
This is the countryside. My name is St. George. I'm a knight. Saturday, July 10th, 8.05 p.m. I was working out of the castle on the night watch when a call came in from the chief. A dragon had been devouring maidens. Homicide. My job. Slay him. You call me, chief?
Yeah, it's the dragon again, devouring maidens. The king's daughter may be next.
Mm-hmm. You got a lead?
Yeah, nothing much to go on. Said you take that 45 automatic into the lab to have him check on it?
Yeah. You were right.
I was right?
Yeah. It was a gun.
Do you really think you can get away with that?
Why not?
It makes fun of the police, and the police preserve law and order, and anyone who is against law and order is against America.
Oh, come on.
However, no good American would buy such a scurrilous record.
But more than a million of them already have. Maybe we better call them back.
Oh. Well, it's anti-British, too.
I'll bite why.
It lampoons St. George, the patron saint of England.
You don't leave me much to satirize.
That's not my problem. There's got to be a censor to keep you fellows in line. There always has been.
Maybe so, but he hasn't always been as tough as you are. Just this year, the world lost a great satirist who knew the bitterness which is the lot of a man in mid-century America who refuses to take things too seriously. You remember his acid sarcasm?
California is a great place to live if you're an orange.
The biting wit of Fred Allen was finally suffocated in a society where slapstick is king and where it is all right for a man to take a pratfall as long as he falls on his own prat. But nothing was sacred to Fred Allen, from network vice presidents to Mom herself.
For 20 years, my mother kept a light burning in the window for me. When I came home, my mother gave me a royal welcome and a gas bill for $729.
Can you guess who got sore at this little interchange?
Well, Mr. Cassidy, what is that ladder you have there?
I'm going over to Sweeney's for dinner.
And you have to carry a ladder?
The dining room table is too high. You can't sit on chairs. Everybody eats on a ladder.
Why is the dining room table so high?
Sweeney is a mounted cop. He always rides into dinner on his horse.
Oh?
Sweeney never uses a napkin. He wipes his hands on the back of his horse. There's so much food on the back of Sweeney's horse, he has mice under his saddle. Goodbye to you.
Well, who do you suppose beefed about that innocuous scene? The mounted police? The American Society of Ladder Manufacturers? Mice? No, the Irish. Or at least a small, militant, vociferous, and humorless group of Irishmen. So finally, Ajax Cassidy was written out of the show. It seems to me that today only two mediums remain where the satirist may operate with the widest latitude. Books and the theater. Elsewhere, there are restrictions of one kind or another. Even in phonograph records, which sometimes end up in locked vaults instead of music store shelves. Here's part of a satire which Dawes Butler and I wrote, but never recorded, and which you are about to hear for the first and last time.
In the Blue Ridge Mountains of Virginia, on a trail of the lonesome pine, well, away, 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 gee whiz, it's a nice day.
That's right, Arthur.
Well, you look like you had a good night's sleep, lad.
That's right, Arthur.
It's a pretty tie you're wearing.
That's right, Arthur. That's right, Arthur.
Oh, I just cleared my throat, is all. See, I was over to the Douglas factory the other day. They had a 1 cent sale. You buy one DC-3 for $100,000, you get the other one for a penny. I think you folks can still get in on it if you hurry right over.
That's right, Arthur.
See, how about a tune from Frank? You want to sing Frank?
Yes, I do, and my name is Frank.
Well, it's Frank as far as I'm concerned.
Frank.
Say, guess who I had warming up in the audition pen this morning?
Who?
Morton Downey.
Call me Frank.
Okay, all those in the cast who want to see my new Honolulu movies, hold up your leg irons.
There isn't time, Arthur. The program's almost over.
Oh, what a shame. Well, I think I got time for one joke. You see this ukulele? I bought it with no strings attached. What's that? What's that noise?
It was me, Arthur. I was drinking a glass of noodle soup when you told that last joke. I wasn't able to laugh in time, so I did the next best thing. I gargled.
See, that's thinking on your feet. Only the quick thinkers stay with me. Hey, you with the freckles, you're fired. Ooh, that's me. I'm looking in the mirror.
That's right, Arthur.
We'll see you Monday, folks. If you want to have some fun over the weekend, get out and build your own airstrip. It's more fun than a barrel of monkeys.
Sing it, Arthur.
In the blue Ridge Mountains of Virginia, on the trail of the lonesome pine.
All right, the censor's still with us, huh?
Oh, very much so. Oh, very funny, very funny.
I thought you'd be gone, but you liked it, huh?
Oh, indeed, I did.
No comment, no cuts? No blue pencil?
Well, no, not really. Now, of course, in all honesty, I must say, I think that last joke was... A wee mite suspect.
What joke was that?
The one about the ukulele with no strings attached.
What's suspect about that?
Well, it does seem to infer that Hawaiians are not above indulging in sharp business practices, such as the sale of stringless ukuleles.
Oh, I see.
But then we must be lenient.
I hadn't noticed.
After all, our ancestors in Connecticut were alleged to have sold wooden nutmegs from time to time. So we can afford to be lenient.
Lenient, huh? Mm. Well, that's a step in the right direction. Now, tell me, Mr. C.
Censor is the name.
Pardon me. Do you consider hi-fi enthusiasts sacred cows?
Hi-fi enthusiasts sacred cows? I don't even know what they are.
Well, then I can speak freely.
radio station WHIFIFM, serving the greater Milltown area, is once more proud to bring you at this time your weekly high fidelity forum of the air. And here is your moderator, Feedback Frugal.
Yeah, thank you. Well, every week at this time, I have to ask all you people listening on anything less than a 15-inch speaker with an 8-inch tweeter to tune out, please. We don't mean to be undemocratic, but we're a select group, and we can't have just anybody listening. Thank you, so get out, please. Well, tonight our panel looks a little bit like who's who in hi-fi. To my right, Mr. H.H. Horn, president of the Summit Ridge Louder and Louder Club. Mr. Horn? Mr. Horn?
And to my right, Mr. Takron Grillcloth, editor of Assemble It Yourself magazine.
Thank you, and good evening. And on my right, a very charming teenager, Miss Rhoda May Flug of the West Branch Falls branch of the Johann Sebastian Bach Fan Club. I believe that's the inscription on your windbreaker, Miss Flug.
I hope your ears are better than your eyes. It says, "Don't knock Bach." That's the slogan of our club.
Oh, that's the slogan.
Yeah, we have jerseys, too, that say, "Every toccata is worth a fugue."
Fine. Thank you, Miss Flug, for the plug. Well, that's our panel. Now, first, we'll play just a teeny bit of a brand new LP recording and see who'll be the first to identify it. Here we go.
I think you'll find it works better if you remove the record jacket first.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Yes, my mistake. Here we go. Dirty jacket. Well, there we are. Now try and identify this. Well, that's about enough of that, I guess. Whoops. Sorry. Well, my arm slipped. I'm sorry. Now, do you know who that was? H.H. Horn had his hand up.
Well, that was played over a Pimlington amplifier model 220.
Right so far.
With a Philly preamp and Magnus tone arm.
What do you mean a Philly preamp? That had over 1.6% hum. You can't get that kind of distortion out of a Philly.
My dear Miss Flug, I can hear up to 20,000 cycles.
All right. If afraid Miss Flug has got you there, H.H. It was a Murdoch Jr. with over 2% hum. Now, what about the turntable, Mr. Grillcloth?
Yes, well, it has quite a bit of rumble in it. I think it was the new Murdoch just on the market.
Right you are. Do you think it'll sell 200,000?
No. They have quite a few bugs in them yet.
I got a Murdoch. It doesn't have any bugs.
What? Well, they've got a rumble like a cement mixer.
Well, sure they do if you don't use a foam rubber spindle adapter.
All right. Did anybody recognize the music?
Tell you the truth, I wasn't listening to the music.
Me either.
Well, no matter. Now we come to our contest. If you can guess the sound, you win a life-size, inflatable, latex rubber Liberace. He comes with his arms extended, ready to be blown up and set down at your own piano.
Oh,
yeah, now what familiar sound is this? Listen. Well, I don't see any hands. That was Benny Goodman in a skin diver suit, 20 feet underwater, playing Danny Boy in a kelp bed.
Oh, yeah.
H.H., you should have had that. Well, now one more just quickly here. Recognize that sound?
I think that was a... No, I give up.
Yeah, what was that?
That was King Farouk in his skin diver suit, 20 feet underwater, applauding Benny Goodman.
Oh, well, if you'd played that on something beside a lousy Murdoch turntable without all that rumble,
What do you mean, lousy Murdoch? I'd like to hear your turntable.
All right, Miss Flug. You'll have an opportunity right now. Mr. Grillcloth has assembled his home hi-fi kit here in the studio, and we're all going to get a little listen, right, Doctor?
Yes. As advertised in our magazine, assemble it yourself. Now, of course, in order to prepare for our kit, you have to rip out all the walls in the interior of your house.
I see.
Next, our acoustical walls go up in sections.
Prefabricated.
More or less. One wall is solid tennis balls. The other asbestos. The third, wet bathing suits. And the fourth, sort of a foam rubber bas-relief mural of the Pickens sisters in repose.
Some acoustics, right? What about equipment?
Well, I use 5 21-inch speakers in the ceiling, as you can see here. I have it all set up there. plus a 10-foot horn enclosure in each corner. I have a Stylemaster preamp in a Fomroy turntable.
Oh, the waste one he could have picked.
Listen, madam, people who own Murdoch turntables should not...
All right, them. Now, how much does all that equipment cost? I know our listeners will be anxious.
Yes, well, I'll tell you.
Find out the cost.
Yes, please, I'll tell you. $5,499.50 takes it home. Of course, the cost of building the railroad spur right to your house, which is essential, is not included.
Not
in
included
that.
In the price. Well, could we hear a little music through your system? I see you have it all set up.
No. No, I'm afraid it wasn't designed for this studio.
Oh, that's a shame.
No, the room won't stand the stress.
Oh, I think it would, but I'm sure our listeners would have enjoyed hearing
sure,
it.
I would have enjoyed hearing it.
No, not me. This way I don't have to hear that more than 5% turntable rumble in that lousy farm, Roy.
Just a minute here, Miss Smart Alec.
Yeah,
all
you right, just take the
panel. Here,
Miss
Blood, put your windbreaker back on, please.
All right, you want to hear a little hi-fi, eh? Well, listen to this.
That concludes our weekly high-fidelity Forum of the Air. Now back to the frothy beat of Claude Hopper and his boys.
There's still hope for laughter in America, for there are still satirists in America. We're a hardy species as difficult to extinguish as liberty itself. Our names are familiar and our lust for laughter cannot be discouraged. You may think of us as cartoonists, writers, comics, perhaps, but we are all fundamentally satirists, from Chaucer to James Thurber, from Moliere to S.J. Perelman, from George Bernard Shaw to Dorothy Parker, Al Capp, Voltaire, Sid Caesar, Groucho Marx, Bob and Ray, Walt Kelly's Pogo, and Jonathan Swift's Lilliput. The list would outrun the time we have left, but all of us all have this in common. In seeking to blow away mankind's absurdities on a gust of ridicule, we hope to make mankind's burden a little easier to bear. Before you reach for that blue pencil, stop and think. Can you imagine life without a laugh?
You have just heard the CBS Radio Workshop production of Colloquy 3, an analysis of satire, starring the Capitol recording artist Stan Freeberg and produced and directed in Hollywood by William N. Robeson. Colloquy 3 was written by Mr. Freeberg and Mr. Robeson, with music by Lynn Murray. Included in the cast were June Foray, Dawes Butler, Sam Pierce, Larry Thor, Parley Bear, Alan Reed, and Bill Thompson. Next week from New York, the workshop will present the radio premiere of The Hither and Thither of Danny Dither, a modern morality play in which a very young angel upsets a celestial efficiency expert's efforts to streamline heaven. Stay tuned for 5 minutes of CBS News, to be followed over most of these same stations by My Son Jeep. And don't forget, CBS, caution before speed. This is the CBS Radio Network.